All right, so welcome everyone. As Adam said, my name is Brent Weinberg. I'm one of the neuroradiology faculty here at Emory. Since I'm a neuroradiologist, I'm going to talk a little bit about spine tumors. And I know that this is something that musculoskeletal radiologists run into a lot. I'm going to emphasize the non-osseous tumors because most of the MSK radiologists are better at osseous tumors than me. So don't expect to see a whole lot of osteoblastomas or anything like that today. But we'll talk about the ones that are arising in the spinal canal and the spinal cord and the things you might think about, like the things that I get asked about the most when looking at spine disease. I've got to start this off with like a big shout out to one of my former colleagues, Michael Hoke, who's now at the University of Pennsylvania. He gave me many of these slides, and many of the cases are from him. And some of these cases have been handed down from other radiologists, so I've tried to denote those when present to give people as much credit as possible. Some of these things are a little bit rare, so it takes a little time to kind of collect them. So what we're going to talk about today is a little bit about making a differential diagnosis for spine tumors by the location. And so helping decide like what your differential is based on where you think the tumor is coming from. We'll take a look at some of the common mimics and pitfalls of these spine tumors. We'll talk a little bit about benign versus pathologic fractures. That'll be sort of the bone component here. We'll talk a little bit about cystic lesions. Like even though they're not tumors per se, they're kind of mass-like and can often mimic tumors. So we'll talk about those as well. So when you have this location-based approach to spine tumors, the spine is really an extension of the brain or the spinal cord anyway is an extension of the brain, and the CNS is all kind of contiguous. So the differentials that you're thinking about are generally the same. And today we're going to, like I said, we're going to ignore the bone lesions. I put a little smiley there since it's the MSK lecture. But when you think about these things, the spinal cord, things that affect the spinal cord tend to be the same things that affect the brain parenchyma. The CSF tend to be the same things that affect the leptomeninges and the basal cisterns, and the dura gives you the same sort of pathologies as well. And so if you can first find a location, then you can make your differential based on the location, which can be extremely helpful. And so when you're categorizing the location, you really have to decide, like, is it in the spinal cord or intramedullary? Is it outside of the spinal cord or extramedullary? And then is it intradural or extradural? So this is just a T2 weighted image of the C spine. And you can see the spinal cord here. And so if it's in the spinal cord, I mean, the whole spinal cord is intradural. And then if it's in the spinal cord, it's intramedullary. And then you have the dura, and the dura is the sac that sort of outlines the CSF. And if it's inside there, you know, your CSF is predominantly contained there, and that's your intradural extramedullary compartment. And then everything else is extradural. So the neural foramina, the bones, the posterior elements are all extradural. And so if you can kind of narrow it down to that, you can usually come up with an intelligent differential without knowing much else about the lesion. And these are some sketches from one of Mike's former teachers, John Lowe at NYU. And I was gonna redo these, so I wasn't like taking material from someone else. But then I decided actually that they're so great that to redo them would be somewhat silly. So I'm not gonna be able to redo those anyway. Here, I mean, you can see that here's the spinal cord, and he's a happy guy. He's sitting in his house, the spinal canal, and so here. You can see if it's expanded, then you're dealing with something that's intramedullary here. If it's pushed to the side, you're dealing with something that's extramedullary. But in this case, you see the dura is maintained. If you have something outside the dura, then it's going to crowd this little guy to the side, but the dura is going to be compacted around it there. So first we'll start off by talking about intramedullary lesions. And like I said, when you're thinking about the intramedullary spinal canal, think about the brain parenchyma, right? Like, and so things that affect the brain parenchyma, primary tumors, and then try to figure out if there's a mass, like is there mass effect or is it primarily like mass neutral or is there even some volume loss? If you're looking at a tumor, the most common tumors that you're going to be dealing with are an ependymoma, or an astrocytoma. Like these are the most common spine tumors, and we'll talk about those a little bit more. Other more rare tumors, like you can definitely see hemangioblastomas and cavernous malformations, like are more associated with hemosiderin and hemorrhages. You can also have a number of things that mimic tumors, right? Inflammatory and demyelinating things. You can get swelling of these processes in sort of the immediate phase. So those are things to think about as well. So we're going to take a little bit of a case-based approach to these things, and I'm going to show you some intramedullary cases. And so here we have a case. This is an intramedullary lesion. This is a 20-year-old. He was having back pain and lower extremity weakness. This case is from Dr. Patel at UVA. But if you look like on the T2 here, so this is a T2 fat sat, like on the left here, you see the cord like actually becomes very bright in the mid-cervical spine. It looks almost as bright as CSF there, and you really lose the definition of the cord there. This is just a regular T2. And you see similar things there. On a post contrast, however, if you look here at the inferior margin, you have this kind of a regularly enhancing mass here. It has sort of ill-defined margins. And when you have kind of mass-like enhancement, so when we think about the criteria here, it looks like we have a mass, we have enhancement. So that's when we have to think about tumors here. And so this is a case of an astrocytoma. This is a different astrocytoma here. This one has some extension like up into the brainstem. Most commonly, astrocytomas in the spine are going to be low grade. They're more common in children. It's the second most common cord tumor. The most common we'll see in just a second. The cervical cord is the most common, and they tend to be kind of infiltrative. You'll have like long segments. If you see, you have a long segment of T2 abnormality here, and that's very common. And unlike tumors within the brain parenchyma, like low-grade astrocytomas tend to enhance. So you don't necessarily know the grade, like from its degree of enhancement there. So this is a sort of counter to that case. So here we have a little bit older patient. This is a 57-year-old. This patient has right deltoid weakness. So they'd had this kind of right weakness for a while. Then they were in a car accident. They got a CT to evaluate their spine for trauma. And then they found this lesion. And so similar to the other lesion, you've got the cord is expanded here. But if you look, the margins are a little bit better defined, right? So here is a T2 and a T2 fat sat. You see like pretty well-defined margins. Looks like there's a little nodule in the center, and on pre and post contrast, you see that little nodule in the center is enhancing there. This is an ependymoma, and this is what ependymomas tend to look like. This example is pretty well behaved, like it's only a single nodule, and the cystic part is pretty well behaved. Here you see another example of like a much less well behaved one. These are cellular ependymomas. They tend to occur anywhere in the cord. They can spread. This is a patient who had neurofibromatosis, so they had kind of these multiple ependymomas. This is the most common cord tumor. It's more common in adults. So if you see an older patient, so this guy was 57, the original guy was in his 20s. And so older patients, like it's more common. So just by age, if you're making an age-based differential, think about ependymoma first in an older patient. These frequently have hemorrhage. They frequently have these like big, long kind of cystic components. So when you're thinking about it, and so here's another couple of cases here. These are both STIR or T2 fat sat images. And we kind of have similar looking lesions to what we saw before. Some mass like expansion here. You see there's a little sort of mass component there. Here you see a mass component down here with some edema in the cord. Like I said, if you were just choosing based on the age, you would say that this one is the ependymoma and this is the astrocytoma. So that's a pretty reasonable way to guess. But also if you take a look, the margins of this tend to be better defined. And this tends to be like more infiltrative. If you look at the axials, the ependymomas tend to be more centrally located. So here you see it's like very centered in the cord. And here you see this one's a little bit off to the patient's right. So this is the pre and post contrast here, or I'm sorry, it's just the post contrast for both. Here again, you see this one on the left is pretty well marginated, whereas this one is sort of very irregular and kind of irregularly marginated here. So perhaps like that enhancement pattern like kind of trumps everything here. But in this case, kind of all the things like add up together This one's an ependymoma. The one on the right is a grade 4 astrocytoma or GBM of the cord. Now, when you're looking at a case like this, you don't necessarily have to come up with an exact diagnosis. I mean, if you can tell the surgeon that you're dealing with either an ependymoma or an astrocytoma, that can often get them to where they need to be, because they're going to have to do a biopsy or surgery to get a definitive diagnosis. But here, this really can help you kind of step up your game in terms of giving them a good differential, is telling them which one you think it's most likely to be. We talked about all of these things, but it's just a little bit of a summary for you. I've highlighted some of the things that I think are most important, where the astrocytoma tends to have more heterogeneous enhancement, whereas the ependymoma tends to be more homogeneous. Children and teenagers tend to have astrocytomas, whereas full-grown adults tend to have ependymomas. So that can kind of help you differentiate them a little bit. These are just GBMs of the cord, and you see they have irregular margins. They can have solid or cystic enhancement. So this is just what a cord glioblastoma looks like. And this makes up a pretty small proportion of cord tumors. The low grades tend to be more common. They're most common in the cervical cord, tend to be relatively young patients, and the survival, unfortunately, like brain glioblastomas, is very poor. And you want to look at the whole neuroaxis to make sure that they don't have glioblastoma in other locations. Sometimes you can have glioblastoma in the brain with spread to the spine, so you want to make sure that they don't have that. Here, I'm just showing you an example. This is one of those cervical spine glioblastomas. This is a different patient. So this is a parietal GBM here. But if you take a look, the enhancement pattern is very similar. So many of these spine lesions, if you took it out of the spine and put it in the brain, you would know what it was immediately, or you'd at least be able to come up with a very good differential. In this case, this GBM looks very similar. So when you see that irregular stipple pattern of enhancement, like irregular margins surrounding edema, think about a glioblastoma. They have neck pain and progressive sensory impairment. So you see the look here is not a whole lot different from the other tumors that we've seen here. You see on the axial, right, this is a T2, but you can hardly even tell like where the margins of the cord are, like where is cord, like where is CSF, and the sagittal is kind of to the medulla here. And then on the post contrast, you've got an enhancing nodule here. If you look, like these two little dots, like maybe are little flow voids, maybe have a little siderosis here. So some of this looks a little bit more like hemorrhage. And in this case, we're looking at a hemangioblastoma. These are less common tumors. It's only a few percent of cord tumors. Not all of them are associated with von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. Like it's only about a third. So even if a patient doesn't have VHL, like you can still have a hemangioblastoma. And for these, like you want to think about a vascular nodule with a cystic component. And so that was very much like what we saw here, like this kind of cystic component around it with a very solid enhancing nodule, kind of like those ependymomas. And it can be very hard to tell the difference. In this case, like one clue that you have is like there's little flow voids like back here along the PL surface. And the degree of that cystic expansion of the cord and the syrinx is a little bit higher in this patient, but you may not be able to tell, and you may just have to give them a differential. If you do see something that looks like this, you want to look for other suspicious things, right? Like you can look down here, like towards the lower part of the thoracic spine, you see some little nodules enhancing along the cord. So these PL nodules are additional hemangioblastomas. You can image through the brain, and this is a kind of a classic posterior fossa hemangioblastoma, where you have a solid enhancing nodule and a cystic component. And these patients with VHL also get endolymphatic sac tumors. As you see, the endolymphatic sac here is expanded. So that's what you can get with von Hippel-Lindau. So if you see that, you're almost certainly looking at a hemangioblastoma. Here we have a fourth case. So this case is a little bit different. This is a 26-year-old man. He had like a kind of a strange history. He was having this T10 sensory loss. He had been like dropped to the ground in an MMA match. And then he was kind of better. He missed work for a few days, and then he was lifting a refrigerator at work, and his symptoms came back. And so his sort of history was very strange. If you took a look at this, now I think most people, you know, if you take a second year radiology resident or third year radiology resident, and you take this lesion and you put it in the brain, they'll know what it is. If you look, this is a T2 fat sat. You have the cord, so we're in the lower thoracic cord. You see this rim of T2 darkness around it. You have a pre-contrast here. It just sort of looks kind of bland or iso-intense to the cord. And then on the post-contrast, there's really minimal or no enhancement here. Now, the first thing you might think about with this sort of unusual history of sort of odd traumas is this a traumatic hematoma to the cord? But if you look, there's no evidence of trauma to the bone. There's no surrounding edema. There's nothing to suggest that this is an acute finding. So I think that's really a clue there. This person, when they were interrogated a little bit more, they'd been having these symptoms for quite a while. This is a cavernous malformation. And you see here on the axials, again, it has that rim of T2 darkness. That's the rim of siderosis. You can actually see that it looks very similar to what it might look like in the brain. When you have familial patients, so patients who have lesions in the brain or multiple cavernous malformations in the brain, they're more likely to have them in the cord. These can have a highly variable clinical course, much like the ones in the brain. They can hemorrhage with a rate of a few percent per year. So the risk of them hemorrhaging and causing symptoms is higher. Typically, if these are symptomatic, they're going to go on to resection. Like the ones in the brain, they tend to be pretty encapsulated. And despite the fact that it looks like you'd be going through a bunch of spinal cord to get to it, they can be resected. I'm not going to say easily, but without as much collateral injury as you might think. Along those same lines, like any time you're looking at someone and they have siderosis in the cord, or if it looks like they have sort of cystic lesions with a fluid level, you've got to think about blood within the cord. And the sort of formal term for blood in the cord is hematomegalia, so it's a hematoma in the cord itself. There's a differential for this, and the tumors that we talked about can definitely hemorrhage. So the ependymomas, hemangioblastomas, and cavernomas can definitely hemorrhage. You also have to think about vascular malformations. People with coagulation disorders or, you know, hemophilia or other coagulation abnormalities, people on anticoagulation, we see increasing numbers of people on Lovenox, on advanced anticoagulation like Eliquis, and you got to think about trauma as well. And so that's kind of your differential. If you see this kind of dark signal stuff, it tends to be dark on T2, dark on T1, and the fluid level is a nice clue. This was also a cavernous malformation, so it's a really ugly looking lesion, but siderosis is kind of the dominant feature there. Now, those are the main intramedullary tumors. You have to think about the mimics, and these mimics, they can be a variety of things, but there's a couple of key things you want to keep in your mind. Vascular, like stroke, inflammatory diseases and demyelinating diseases, like you definitely have to think about, and treatment-related conditions like radiation necrosis, like you have to think about that as well. I'll show you some examples here. This is an example. I apologize, there's a little bit of noise outside my house. They're doing some construction next door. So hopefully that's not too bad. In any case, here you see the cord is expanded here on T2. You have a little bit of enhancement here. In this case, though, the onset of symptoms was very abrupt, and that can be a nice clue that you're looking at a cord infarct. Here, this is a kind of terrible-looking DWI, but what you can see is there's areas of abnormal diffusion, like centrally within the cord there. So cord infarct is something you want to think about. The vast majority of time, the symptom onset will tell you something about that, or they'll be associated with aortic syndromes, aortic dissection, or aortic surgery. So definitely think about infarction. Sarcoidosis is a tremendous mimic, and we see more sarcoid than I would have really imagined. I didn't really think about sarcoid that much when I was in medical school, but we see a fair amount of it in neuroradiology, and I think it's particularly prevalent in the south of the U.S. Here you see, again, like a mildly expanded cord. It's kind of T2 bright here. A little bit of enhancement, but the enhancement is not really like those tumors. It's a little bit on the surface of the cord. That tends to be like kind of a classic appearance for sarcoidosis, but it really can mimic tumors. You can have solid nodular enhancement. So if you see something and you're thinking it might be sarcoid, think about the other things you can test. Think about looking for an ACE level. Think about looking for a chest X-ray or chest CT to look for nodules in the chest. This is a case of demyelinating disease, in this case, neuromyelitis optica. It looks very similar to that sarcoid case, actually. You have kind of some enhancement along the surface of the cord, a little bit of heterogeneous enhancement kind of over a long segment. But if you look at this, it's not nearly as expanded as those tumors that we saw. So when you don't see as much expansion, like think about one of these inflammatory or demyelinating syndromes. And finally, we have this case of radiation. And here you see this is a T2. So you have a kind of long segment T2 abnormality in the cord here, in the upper thoracic cord. You see pretty aggressive looking enhancement there. You'd be hard pressed to say that this isn't a tumor without an appropriate history. The history is really important here. This was a 56-year-old. He had a history of mantle cell lymphoma. He had received radiation to his upper chest. And if you look at the marrow, like if you take a look at the marrow, like starting from about T5 or T6 here, up to the lower cervical spine, the marrow is distinctly different. It's more T2 abnormal. And so this patient had received radiation to a radiation field in the upper chest and thymus. And that was directly corresponding to this. So the treatment for this is very different. Like you can watch this, you can give steroids and see if it gets larger, as opposed to saying, you know, coming outright and saying that you think this is a cord GBM where you're gonna have to biopsy it and treat it like very aggressively. That's gonna make a big difference. So if you have any unusual history, like think about unusual things like radiation. As I said, always look in that chart to try to get like a little bit of better history. And a final thing that like we might think about is you can have syrinx. So syrinx is a condition where you have expansion of the cord, of the central canal. It's sort of the equivalent of hydrocephalus within the cord. And pre-syrinx is kind of when you get edema around that central canal. And in that case, you want to be on the lookout for that. But here it almost looks like there could be a tumor there. But if you come up higher and you look at the cervical spine, you see that there's a patient who has very low cerebellar tonsils and actually has a Chiari malformation. And this is a pre-syrinx or syrinx in the thoracic canal related to impaired CSF flow. This is another case. So you have, apologize for the noise there. You have some enhancement of the cord itself. So this is a post-contrast. There's all of this enhancement here. But if you do a myelogram, you see the contour of the cord is very sharply demarcated here. You see this is what we call the scalpel sign. And in this case, this is an arachnoid adhesion or an arachnoid web where it's a band compressing the spinal canal there. And it's leading to all of this inflammatory enhancement there and expansion of the canal. These are relatively uncommon, but you definitely will see them. And they get misinterpreted as tumors relatively frequently. So when you see that scalpel sign, like think about arachnoid adhesions. So intramedullary lesions are really they're the bread and butter of the spinal lesions. Think about the cord as an extension of the brain. Think about the most common tumors. So if you see an enhancing tumor, if you call it an ependymoma or astrocytoma, you're going to be right more than 90% of the time. If you see some other features that sort of point you towards hemangioblastoma or CAVML, then think about that as well. Those mimics inflammatory disease and other things can definitely be a mimic as well. So now we're going to move on, and I'm showing this drawing again. We want to think about things that are not in the cord but are still within the dura. And these are most commonly masses. Like you can have some inflammatory processes there, but they tend to be masses like schwannomas, meningiomas, and other nerve sheath tumors or neurofibromas. If you have multiple ones, like think about metastatic disease. So this is a peripheral nerve sheath tumor, and we use peripheral nerve sheath tumor to kind of lump in all benign and malignant kind of primary nerve tumors. When they enhance and are made of Schwann cells, we tend to call them schwannomas. But when we talk about neurofibromas, like they tend to be on the same spectrum. These are slow growing tumors. They tend to rise in the neural foramen, like here. They tend to have this dumbbell shape. So we hear them called dumbbell lesions because they're a little bit constrained by the neural foramen. They can erode into the bone and cause smooth remodeling of the bone there. And they're also associated with neurofibromatosis. So neurofibromatosis 1, they tend to get these plexiform neurofibromas. And at type 2, they get schwannomas. This is a neurofibroma here, and so it's coming in from the neural foramen. I flipped this little guy so you can see like how it mimics that. You have a tumor here in the cervical spine. It's pushing the cord to the side. And neurofibromas, like they tend to be less than 5 centimeters. They tend to have less enhancement than schwannomas, but if you have a solitary one, it's very difficult to tell the difference. If they don't have enhancement, I tend to call them neurofibromas. If they have a lot of enhancement, I tend to call them schwannomas. But here you see something, this is called a T2 hypointense target sign. So you see it's hypointense centrally here. This is a patient with neurofibromatosis, and type 1 neurofibromatosis is associated with these plexiform neurofibromas. So you'll see like many neurofibromas along the nerve roots, and that involve like multiple adjacent nerve roots, which is what makes them plexiform. You'll see associated meningocele and dural ectasia. So these are plexiform neurofibromas here. These can degenerate into malignant tumors. And so all of these schwannomas and nerve sheath tumors can degenerate into malignant tumors. And so this is what we would call a malignant nerve sheath tumor. And you might think that they have a higher tendency for malignancy if they have necrotic regions and if they're associated with rapid expansion or associated with pain. So if the patients have pain, then you definitely want to think about whether they could be malignant. Neurofibromatosis 2 is associated with is sort of what we would call MSK syndrome, and it's associated with multiple tumors. Those are schwannomas, meningiomas, and ependymomas. So many of the things we've already talked about today. Type 2 neurofibromatosis like typically don't have neurofibromas. So this is a schwannoma, and here's an example. And so this is an intradural extramedullary lesion. So all of these lumbar lesions that are below the conus are extramedullary by definition because there's no spinal cord down there. And here you see a well-defined lesion in the thecal sac here at L3, L4. And it has sort of avid enhancement. It's got a little cystic lesion right there. This is a very common location and an appearance for a schwannoma. Solitary schwannomas, like I said, are more common than neurofibromas. They tend to have that enhancement and some cystic changes in the center. Hemorrhage and calcification like can happen, but it's less common. And some of these can be completely extradural, but many times they're going to have an intradural component. Here we see, this is another. Hold on a second. I stayed at home because I thought it would be quieter, but in fact, like this is the one time they'd be doing the most construction. This is a 74-year-old woman. She has an intradural extramedullary lesion, and you see like a similar degree of enhancement here. You have this enhancing nodule here, and so it's right here. It's a little bit hard to tell whether it's intradural extramedullary or intradural intramedullary, but if you look at the axials, you'll see that it's a little bit to the side here. It's like really along the side. And if you kind of follow it on the axials, you'll see that this is actually the spinal cord here, which is pushed off to the side. So it's actually deviated to the other side. This woman was having pain in her left shoulder and arm. And this was a meningioma here. So you'll see like you have a little bit of a dural tail here, perhaps. They can really mimic these schwannomas. It can be hard to tell. If you see a calcified lesion within the spinal canal, like definitely think about meningiomas. If you saw this within the brain, again, like within the calvarium, you would be almost certain this was a meningioma. So definitely think about meningiomas. They're the same as the ones within the brain. Like they're treated with surgery and radiation. So you resect them. The grade twos and threes get radiation. The grade ones like typically get only monitoring. This is just an example of an in-plaque meningioma. So this is where you see like it's kind of sort of a long segment. You can see the dura actually coming through here. And you can see it's kind of expanding the spinal canal here. This is another case here. This is my apologies. Here you can see this lesion here in the upper lumbar spine. I'm sorry, it's a very well-defined lesion. It's kind of pushing the conus to the side. This is a 12-year-old male. He's got back pain. It's a very, very well-defined lesion here, and kind of pushing the conus to the side, but definitely extramedullary. Here you have a follow-up, and you see like some enhancing nodules here. This is you see the post-radiation changes here. So this patient got proton therapy, so you see the radiation only affects the. Sorry, I'm just pausing like when the noise gets the worst. Here you see the radiation changes only in the posterior part of the vertebral body. But you have some recurrent nodules here. Here you see if you go a little bit lower, this is now post-treatment again. You see some enhancing nodules here. So you've got all of this together. And those enhancing nodules like keep getting bigger. This is what a mixopapillary ependymoma looks like. And so these like tend to look kind of like schwannomas. They occur along the distal aspect of the cauda equina. And you can definitely get these recurrent nodules at the conus. So you definitely want to look for those. You definitely want to look at the radiation changes, and that can tell you, that can give you a clue that like there's been some treatment before. These mixopapillary ependymomas are always grade one, but they can be very, very locally aggressive. But they don't degenerate into grade two or grade three tumors. This is a case of melanoma. You see these nodules here. They are sort of along the conus here. You have a bunch of nodules. This looks very similar to the mixopapillary ependymoma with the nodularity there. So you see that. This is a patient who happened to have melanoma. So those are, this is a case of metastatic disease. Lymphoma is something you definitely want to look for. So when you have something outside of the conus here or outside of the an extramedullary lesion, here you can see the conus like doesn't look quite right on T2. It looks very, very unusual there. On T1, you can't really see anything. This post-contrast is so abnormal. It can almost give you the impression that you're looking at a T2 because it's outlining the conus and the whole thing is like very enhancing and bright. And on diffusion, like you really shouldn't see anything below the cord, but here the whole fecal sac is filled up with abnormal diffusion material. This was a patient with HIV and lower extremity weakness who happened to have secondary lymphoma in the setting of HIV. Whenever you're looking at metastatic disease, there's some common conditions that you have to think about. You have to think about lung or breast cancer. Melanoma, we see a lot of. You can certainly have GBM, but it's more rare. In pediatric patients, the things you have to think about are a little bit different. Like you think more about lymphoma, leukemia, like brain tumors, like medulloblastoma and pineal tumors. This is another case here. Here I have a GRE of the brain. And so you see like there's some siderosis here, like along the Sylvian fissures, maybe a little siderosis along the surface of the cerebellum. Here, if you come down to the lumbar spine, so anytime you see siderosis in the brain, you want to look at the spine. And here you see there's a lesion expanding the spinal cord here. and expanding the whole spinal canal. If you look at the sagittals on T2, it's very expansile. It's kind of T1, sort of it's iso-intense to the disc or kind of iso-intense to muscle, but very avidly enhancing. And you see there's a bunch of flow voids here. And when you see that, this is a rare but kind of a classic appearance of a paraganglioma. And so if you see something that looks like a mix of papillary ependymoma, but has a bunch of flow voids, then think about that being a paraganglioma. These are quite rare. Like I've only seen a couple in my entire career, but they're definitely something that that you want to be aware of. Here, this is another intradural extramedullary lesion. So here you see something that's very bright on T2. You see, this is a T1. So you see the CSF is dark. They're very bright on T1 and T2. And then if you apply fat suppression, you see it actually gets dark here. There's another nice clue here. If you look at this T2, you see like a chemical shift artifact around it here. So you see the chemical shift here. And so that tells you that you're dealing with a juxtamedullary lipoma. So it's a lipoma of the conus here. And so this is called a terminal lipoma. They can be associated with a tethered cord. It can be associated with cutaneous syndromes like port wine stains and those other cutaneous syndromes. But when you see them, there'll be fat density. So they'll suppress on fat suppressed imaging. And then they'll also sometimes see that chemical shift artifact. If you don't have the benefit of fat suppression, if you do a CT, like you'll see that their fat density. This is just an example of a fatty phyllum. So we see this a lot. It's just a single like linear thing there. When it becomes more mass-like though, then we'll call that a terminal lipoma. So in summary, like when you're dealing with intradural extramedullary lesions, like you'll see the cord is smashed to the side. We want to think mainly about meningiomas, think about nerve sheath tumors, think about less common masses like ependymomas, metastases, and lipomas. Now, finally, we'll go through the extradural lesions. I'll point out that it's been said that the whole world is extradural, so everything that's not in the spinal canal is outside the spinal canal. But you can kind of think about that when you're thinking about what can be extradural. The discs are extradural. So if you have a protrusion or an extrusion, disc infection, bone lesions, so something you guys as musculoskeletal radiologists like think about a lot. In terms of lymphoma, things coming out of the bone, meningiomas can also be extradural. Schwannomas and neurofibromas, like if they start a little bit more peripherally, can be extradural. And then blood vessels, like vascular malformations, can be extradural as well. For extradural, it can be very difficult to find an exact diagnosis. Many are going to have to be biopsied. CT can be a really great tool. And I think CT is a great tool for any bone lesions. It's like the best friend of the musculoskeletal radiologist is the plain film and the CT, really to see the extent of bone there. DWI can be helpful as well because highly cellular material like tends to be very bright. So here's our first extradural case here. You see this person's had prior surgery. So they've got a big laminectomy here. They've got this lesion in the ventral epidural space here. You see an abnormal disc there. If you look on T1, it's kind of a very iso-intense to the disc there. And you can kind of draw a line back to the disc. But if you look, like the enhancement pattern is very concerning here, right? Like it can really throw you off. If you saw this without this post contrast, you would say this is probably a disc. The enhancement though, if you look at this, it's all peripheral. The central part is still contiguous with the disc. And so here you're looking at a disc extrusion. Herniated discs can definitely enhance in the acute setting. So you don't want to be too thrown off by that. Here we have a second case. Here we see a primary bone lesion. So something is in the bone of probably the T10 vertebral body here. Oh, I'm sorry, this is T12. And it's bright on T2. This is a post contrast with fat saturation. So it's enhancing there. Here you see the axial post contrast. It's definitely avidly enhancing here. This got called an atypical hemangioma. But if you take a look, probably you want to think about getting a CT. This looks very aggressive, like maybe it's not a hemangioma. If you look at the CT, it looks not typical for hemangioma. It's very unusual. You've got some pathologic fracture. You've got involvement of the pedicle. This was the patient like looked back. They had a prior. It was getting progressively worse. This ultimately had to be biopsied, but was lymphoma. So you can have lymphoma and arising in the bone. That was a B-cell lymphoma. Any case you see like this, if you recommend a CT or an X-ray, definitely that can help you. Like I'm pretty sure most people on the CT would not call this a hemangioma. So definitely think about using a CT. Here, when you see a CT, you can kind of think about that trabecular pattern and what it might look like. Hemangiomas like tend to have the what we'd call like a trabecular pattern or a sort of a corduroy appearance where you see like little dots of trabecula centrally here. This one has more bone destruction and some cortical destruction. This giant cell tumor has pretty well-defined margins, but areas of cortical destruction. This case of Paget's disease has a lot of new bone formation and sclerosis and cortical thickening. So this trabecular pattern could kind of help you a little bit, although many times you're going to have to biopsy these lesions to get a diagnosis. Here we have our third extradural case. Here we have a case, this is a 31-year-old with back pain and paresthesias. We see this big expansile sort of lesion here, sort of off to the side, maybe coming from the neural foramen or at least involving the neural foramen. And then you see this low signal stuff in the middle, like so on T1 and or T2 and T1, it's dark. On post-contrast, it's dark. So again, like think about like what you might want next. You want a CT. This was a case of osteosarcoma. So there's a lot of new bone formation here, a lot of soft tissue components, which could really kind of throw you off. But with this new bone formation, you're thinking about a bone-forming tumor. So in those cases, like think about things coming from the bone. This is sort of more osteoid appearing matrix, and some of the musculoskeletal radiologists can tell you a little bit more about matrix formation, but it doesn't have those kind of classic rings and arcs like you'd see with chondroid matrix. But if you can tell someone, I think this is a bone tumor, that's often enough, and that will get you to the biopsy that you need to perform. Now, this is an insufficiency fracture. Here you have a few images through the lumbar spine. This patient has back pain. You see like there's loss of normal signal there. So fractures like our extramedullary lesions, extradural lesions, if they're associated with tumors, they can kind of bulge into the spinal canal. This one, this is DWI here. The DWI is completely normal. You don't see expansion here. Like you can have enhancement associated with these, but not a lot. This is just a pure insufficiency fracture. This is more of a pathologic appearance to the fracture. You've got, sort of see this end plate destruction here, but you see this bowing of the spinal canal here. So mass-like expansion of the vertebral body itself. This was metastatic melanoma. So here you see on diffusion, it's really pushing into the spinal canal here. When you're looking at and you have fractures, the things like I've already pointed out are things you might think about when you see a paraspinal mass, when the vertebral body is bulging more into the thecal sac, then think about that being a pathologic fracture. This is a case of a patient who had just diffuse leukemia. So the bone is just sort of completely replaced with abnormal signal. You see the diffusion is sort of very abnormal in all the bones. This can be leukemia or lymphoma, but with those, like sometimes you can have extension like into the spinal canal. So think about those as tumors as well. When you have epidural tumor, there's something you might think of as the drape sign or the curtain sign. When especially you have the ventral epidural space that's involved, you see that dura is pushed down like these drapes here. And so you see that it's sort of contained in the epidural space. So think about some sort of epidural process there. So if you have lymphoma or metastatic disease, like it can cause that kind of appearance there. Here you see an example of epidural tumor. So you have, this is myeloma, and you have this lesion is replaced with an enhancing lesion. You have enhancement in the ventral epidural space, the dorsal epidural space, and it's kind of expanded here. So whenever you see that, this is again an extradural lesion, and so it's coming from the bone there. This was myeloma. again, you can see the extra osseous component here, the soft tissue component, if you think about something that's replacing the bone. Here's an additional extradural case. So here we are we're in the cervical spine. Looks kind of similar to that case that we were seeing in the other patients, a little bit higher. But this lesion, it's pretty T2 bright here. Looks like it's kind of centered in the neural foramen. It's pre-contrast, it's iso-intense to the muscle. On post-contrast, it's very avidly enhancing. This person was having shoulder pain. If you look, here's the T2 through the cervical spine. You see kind of that dura is pushed to the sides. This is an extradural lesion again. You see some erosion of the bone. So on pre and post-contrast, we have this avidly enhancing mass. And then we see on diffusion, it looks very bright. It's very cellular looking material here. This turned out to be a chordoma. And anytime you see a lesion along the sort of course of the notochord, so kind of going all the way down from the clivus, all the way down to the sacrum, you can see a T2, very T2 hyperintense mass. They can enhance variably, but tend to enhance a little bit. They tend to be large and before they're symptomatic. And often these are going to require biopsy and surgical resection. The most common locations are the sacrum and the clivus, but you can definitely get them throughout the spine as you saw in this case. Finally, when you think about other extradural lesions, so here we have these are three different dorsal extradural lesions. They're all T2 bright. The enhancement pattern can help you differentiate these. Here you see three different enhancement patterns. This one is solid, so you have some solid central enhancement. Here you have peripheral enhancement, and here you have essentially no enhancement. When you're looking at the solid enhancement, that's central, think about a tumor. When you see peripheral enhancement, think about a fluid collection or infection. And when you have no enhancement, think about hematoma or some bland fluid collection there. So that enhancement pattern can help you out with some of these extradural lesions. I'll wrap up here with a few like extradural lesions you need to at least be aware of. This is an older gentleman, so in his 50s, he's got progressive myelopathy or progressive weakness. And you see he's got his spinal cord is like very T2 hyperintense. So you'd be forgiven for thinking that there's a tumor like actually in the conus and the cord. But if you look, the kind of special feature that you see is you see these flow voids again. This is kind of the classic appearance of a dural AV fistula. But you can get enhancement with these. Like in fact, like the conus was very avidly enhancing and expanded in this patient. So unfortunately, like these can be hard to locate, but you've got to be thinking about them a little bit because they can have a delayed diagnosis. Here you see the spinal angiogram and there's an abnormal connection here. And you get a lot of distended veins like throughout the whole spinal canal. So that can definitely create some problems here. Dural AV fistulas tend to be elderly men. They get progressive myelopathy and they get this long segment cord edema. And that's why you can really be confused into thinking it's an intramedullary process or a tumor. It's only those abnormal vessels that are going to clue you in. These typically are not diagnosed. I think the average delay to diagnosis is like about a year. And so you definitely want to be aware of that and like think about that. Otherwise you won't, if you're not thinking of it, you won't make that diagnosis. One final extradural case I'll show you, and these are very rare, but if you see progressively expansile masses that have some fat signal in them, this is a dorsal lesion. It's in the dorsal fat there. It's got some enhancement there, but it's pretty bright on the pre-contrast. You want to think about angiolipomas. These are rare benign tumors that are involving the fatty and vascular elements, but you'll see fat in them on CT, and they're most common in the thoracic spine. They tend to span two or more vertebral bodies. So in summary, like think about the whole world as extradural. You're thinking about things like the disc, the bone, the meninges, like everything else. Infection can also be a problem, but any tumors that can occur outside the fecal sac, outside the dura, can compress the spinal canal and cause an appearance like that. I'll just give a little bit of description of some cystic lesions. Like sometimes you can have things that don't enhance. Most of the time, like these are intradural and extramedullary. You can do myelograms to see if these fill with contrast, but most of the time they're not going to enhance. Here, you can see there's the cord here is kind of compressed anteriorly. You can see on T2, it's very bright there. And in any case, you can do a myelogram here, and you can see that this actually on the myelogram, like you can see it outlines a little lesion there. It is filling with contrast a little bit, but this is what an arachnoid cyst can look like. So it's very T2 bright, causing some deflection of the cord. You see on the MR, it would be very hard to differentiate from an adhesion or something like that. But here you see the sort of cystic component a lot better. They tend to be CSF intensity on all the sequences. They can cause bone remodeling because of those pulsations. They can fill on the myelogram. Here you see, this is another kind of cystic lesion of the conus here. This person is having lower extremity symptoms. Maybe they have a little T1 bright material there. But you see it's predominantly cystic, a little T2 siderosis there perhaps. This is a dermoid, okay, and here you have another dermoid here. They tend to look cystic. They can mimic those arachnoid cysts, but often they're going to have some fatty elements. They're not going to have as much diffusion restriction as an epidermoid, so not like those ones in the brain that are very, very DWI bright. They can cause a chemical meningitis if they rupture. And finally, like a cystic lesion, very common in the lower sort of along the clivus or in the cervical spine. You see this very T2 bright thing here. It's a little brighter than CSF. It's a little bit darker than CSF on T1. And this is, you see, if you do a myelogram, you can see it does not fill at all. So you might be thinking it's an arachnoid cyst or some sort of cystic lesion. This is an MR myelogram. So again, it's like not filling there. And this is a neuroenteric cyst. And you can do tractography to see the cord tracks like fanning out around that. They can be associated with vertebral abnormalities. They tend to be like just not quite like CSF. So a little bit different from CSF, but you may have difficulty differentiating them from an arachnoid cyst. So in summary, like I'll just leave you with this, like take a location-based approach to these things. If they're intramedullary, like think about ependymomas or astrocytomas. If they're intradural but extramedullary, like the most common are schwannomas and meningiomas. And then extradural, like there's really a broad differential. Like you've got to think about bone tumors, metastases, lymphoma, kind of all of those things. Think about the spine as just being an extension of the CNS. Many times you won't be able to give a definitive differential, but if you can localize the lesion, you can really give a useful differential, and that can be very very helpful. And if you don't know what's going on, if you're just completely at a loss, think about doing a CT. Think about imaging the brain. Because a lot of times if someone has a brain lesion that looks similar, that may give you a clue that you're looking at demyelinating disease, that you're looking at lymphoma, that you're looking at a GBM, that's multifocal. I'm gonna stop here. We can have some questions. If you wanna check out, I have a website, Learn Neuroradiology, where I have a lot of videos about these things. And you can follow us on Twitter, like we talk about these cases and things like that. I apologize for the noise this morning. It's funny, they've been doing construction like in my neighborhood for quite some time. But it's been on hold like completely like until today. And of course they decide to do it this morning. So with that, I'll turn it back over to Adam and we can have any questions that you guys have.
Thank you, Brent. That was an excellent talk. We really appreciate your time. A number of questions have come in. So the first one was how often you perform diffusion weighted imaging of the spine in general. Is this like a callback situation? Do you do it routine? How helpful do you find it in general? Any sort of technical tips to getting optimized diffusion weighted imaging of the spine?
Diffusion of the spine is particularly painful because the quality tends to be quite poor because many parts of the spine are affected by motion. You've got a lot of motion from breathing. You've got vascular pulsations. So particularly in the thoracic and lumbar spine, like it'd be very challenging. We don't do it on all cases, like by routine. It tends to be a callback or when we know there's a tumor or suspected infection. The keys are to having a small field of view diffusion sequence that's really optimized for spine. The bigger the field of view is, like the worse it tends to be. So small field of view sagittal or small field of view axial like tends to be the best. But you saw like for these, like I think like one of my diffusion images, like even though I said like, oh, that was the best example I could find. So it tends to be kind of rife with problems, but we kind of do the best we can. And it's just another piece of information.
And is this something you do routinely, or do you do this as a callback situation, or how does it work for you?
We do not do it routinely. Although if we know there's a tumor, then I would say it's reasonable to do it, on tumors.
Do you use it for bone tumors as well, or just cord?
I think it's useful for bone tumors as well. If anything, like it may give you a target like for a biopsy, because it will show you the most cellular lesions, and it might help you find an ideal target, because it can be hard to kind of figure out like where you want to target these things.
As a follow-up to that, diffusion seems to be the hot topic as of late. What B values do you use when you do these protocols?
I think most of the spine diffusion has a B value of 1,000, like the same as the brain, but I think there's a lot of like research into higher B value imaging, like going as high as like 2,000 or 3,000.
Okay. Another person asked, when you're trying to differentiate an aggressive hemangioma from a plasmacytoma, what do you find to be most helpful?
An aggressive hemangioma from a plasmacytoma. I mean, I think most of the time, like what's going to help you in that is like the patient's age. So patients with plasmacytomas and myeloma related diseases like tend to be older. Their serum markers like tend to be very useful, because they'll have abnormal IgG, they'll have abnormal immunoglobulins. So that can be like a nice clue. But many times you're not going to be able to tell, like you're going to have to do a biopsy. Hemangiomas, like you may have more than one. So if you have like one aggressive looking hemangioma in a segment of the spine, and you have five other pretty typical looking hemangiomas, like that might tip your balance like a little bit, like, so look elsewhere. But like in the primary lesion, I think it can be quite challenging.
Okay.
I don't know if you have, maybe you have some additional insight in that. Like I think they can be really hard.
Yeah. I mean, I think they can be tough as well. I think specifically they were asking because they both tend to be expansile and have coarse intrabecula. Sometimes it can be a challenge. And I agree, you know, if there's any remnant of like a polka dot sign, you know, that would be helpful. You talk about the cerebral sort of brain appearance.
Yeah. I mean, I think if you have like probably the more trabecula you have retained, the less I'm thinking about plasmacytoma. A lot of plasmacytomas like tend to get rid of the bone completely, but you can get that like cerebriform appearance or whatever that's described.
Yeah. Another question. So let's say you're faced with a scenario where either it's an NF patient or just a non-NF patient, and they have what's suspected to be a peripheral nerve sheath tumor. What are the criteria that you use to determine whether or not you think something needs a biopsy, because we often see cystic degeneration of them and it becomes a request for a biopsy.
So a patient with a known schwannoma or neurofibromas, and when would you decide to biopsy basically?
Or if you don't have priors for comparison to say it's been stable for, you know, if it's a de novo case or one where you don't have available prior images.
I mean, that's a really good question. I mean, I think, many times the patients will be able to tell you if they have new symptoms or if they have an increase in size. Like if they have increasing size, like that's definitely pretty suspicious. Like increasing pain is awfully suspicious. I mean, that one that I showed is like the worst possible example of like cystic degeneration. I mean, it's very necrotic. I think if I saw any that was like that large and looked necrotic, I would suggest that it might be worthy of biopsy. But a lot of times, like you're gonna have to put it back on the ordering service to ask for if the patient has pain, if they've noticed a change, because it, I mean, in many cases, like they didn't have symptoms and now they do have symptoms, and then that would like point me towards a biopsy. Any like big necrotic looking mass, I would be a little bit concerned about malignant degeneration, but But even so, like most of these, like you may have to have a short-term follow-up, like, you know, do a follow-up in, you know, 6 to 12 weeks or something like that, and seeing if it's changing quickly, then of course you'd want to biopsy it. If not, you may have to space out the follow-up a little bit more. And because I don't think there's any easy answer about when to biopsy those.
That's a great lead-in for the next question. Somebody asked for the radiation change case that you showed in the cord. You mentioned, you know, a potential follow-up, especially if you don't have all the clues that you had there. What would you suggest in terms of a follow-up interval if you're suspecting radiation changes in the cord and you're not sure if there's tumor there?
I think follow-up interval in radiology is like the problem that's most rife with difficulty, because we don't have a lot of great evidence to show like what our follow-up intervals. And like, sometimes I'm teaching fellows, but many times I'm just like taking a guess, like, yeah, 6 to 12 weeks, like sounds great. In the brain, if you have like radiation necrosis in the brain, like after treatment of a brain tumor, a follow-up like might be like in the month to 2 months sort of range, like the 4 to 8 weeks, like 6 weeks, something like that. I think like something like that in the cord like would be appropriate, because you're essentially looking at the same process, so probably like 1 to 2 months, like something like that. If that's truly a cord GBM, it's going to get worse. If it's not getting worse, then you're thinking about is it a lower grade tumor, or are you looking at something else? Incomplete history is a huge issue though.
Gotcha. Okay, the last question, for a de novo case where you don't have priors again and you come across what you think is a syrinx or syringohydromyelia, and you only have one portion of the cord image, it goes to the edge maybe, do you typically recommend contrast? Do you feel like contrast is helpful? And do you typically do more imaging of the spine?
Yes. So anytime you have an unexplained syrinx and you didn't do contrast imaging, you need to do contrast, because the main cause, or the number one worrisome cause of an unexplained syrinx, is going to be a tumor. So that there's either an astrocytoma or ependymoma there, and that's what's causing the syrinx. So I think, yes, you want to do contrast. And when you bring them back for contrast, I would probably go ahead and image the remainder of the unimaged spine, right? So if you did a cervical spine, then I would go ahead and recommend like imaging the remainder of the spine to see if there's other lesions, because like there other lesions can be a clue. Or like in that case where it was a thoracic lesion, the C-spine kind of gives you the answer, like because you've got that kind of Chiari appearance to the cerebellar tonsils. So I would say yes, do contrast. Yes, do the rest of the spine for all of those unexplained syrinx.
Fantastic. Okay, well, that exhausts all the questions. Really appreciate your time. Excellent talk today. And we thank you very much for what you've taught us today. So.
All right, well, thanks so much for having me. I appreciate it. And it was a pleasure joining you guys. You guys feel free to email or Twitter me or whatever if you guys have questions.
All right. Thanks, Brent. And thanks, everyone, for tuning in. See you next week. Everyone stay safe.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
All right.